Hi, I'm here with Jaye Viner, author of Jane of Battery Park, which was our November My Librarian Book Club pick. Welcome, Jaye. How are you?
Hello, I'm good. I'm happy to be here.
Thanks. We're really glad to have you. Each month, librarians choose a book that librarians love and want to read and want to share with our readers. And this month, it's your debut novel, because now you have a trilogy as well, which I want to talk about at the end. But Jane of Battery Park is your first book. And can you give us a quick plot synopsis summary?
Yep. So Jane of Battery Park is a romantic thriller in the vein of Romeo and Juliet without the tragedy and without teenagers. So it's for adults with adults in it. And basically, Jane is the Juliet character, and she comes from, there it is, we'll call it a cult kind of family background, where her brothers and her husband basically have tried to they're trying to reform America by putting celebrities on show trials for their quote-unquote sins, and so the book follows her life after that, where she's trying to kind of start over. She has a new identity. She's living basically in secret from her family for good reasons. And the story follows her relationship with Daniel, who is a has-been heartthrob. He had like a one-hit wonder when he was a very young, attractive male, and hasn't done anything since for various reasons. But he has an older brother who's kind of his claim to fame, and he does management for his brother's, you know, Hollywood stardom, basically. And so they meet, as people do in romance novels, by chance circumstances. And they basically try and make it work with this kind of dynamic that it's easy for them when they're on their own, but then when their families get involved, her past non-existent family and then his present family, you have this kind of clash of cultures that mirrors Romeo and Juliet, that's modern day America, essentially. It does have a happy ending, so don't worry.
They have an 8-year gap between when they first met and when they reconnect. So why did you work that into the story? I feel like, first of all, I just want to say that, you know, this was very well written. You know, it's a wonderfully rich book with, you know, really nuanced storyline and, you know, so unique. And, but yeah, I just wondered, because I kept reading it, I'm like, you know, Battery Park is in New York, but she's in LA and he's from Hawaii, California. So where does it come in? Excuse me.
Yeah, I don't know if California is the middle between New York and Hawaii, but that is it. If it is, it's an accident. Basically, I wanted to have this, like, an ideal moment, like when you meet someone and you're young, and it would have worked, but it didn't. And so me being beyond the young part of my life now, I mean, the middle young part of my life, we'll say, I wanted to have this opportunity for people who maybe missed their chance. And I think a lot of people have that story where they think of, well, what could have been? And so they have this kind of perfect meeting when they're young people, and then they go on with their lives. And there's a lot of plot things that, you know, there's reasons that that didn't happen, which I'm not going to spoil for you. But I love the idea of them having that second chance, even if it's for romance reasons, and even if it's not quite plausible in real life, for the whole wide world for them to end up in the same place a second time in Los Angeles. But I think it makes it more compelling for when you realize what you've lost, possibly. And so when you have that second chance, they kind of go for it in ways that I think people who are younger wouldn't necessarily, because they don't. They think they have all the chances. Whereas when you get on in life, and especially if you've had a bad experience, you don't let that go for granted anymore.
Very true. Yes. And I love that they kind of have so much in common as far as, you know, running, kind of escaping from their families. Right.
Right.
But also, and this was what I thought made it sort of dystopian, which I wanted to talk about too, because I do agree that it's a contemporary romance thriller. And but dystopian, yes, but do you think the disability storyline made it dystopian in a way? Or what do you think makes it dystopian?
So I guess dystopian is a very broad umbrella that I use to think about alternative versions of contemporary America or contemporary life. And so we tend to think of the Hunger Games as dystopian, kind of our famous example right now, or George Orwell, if you didn't hate your English class in high school. Where we're looking at American culture and we're trying to pull things out from it and exaggerating certain things. And so dystopian for me is having this group of perfectly almost normal Midwestern families who have done this extreme thing of trying to reform America by doing show trials of celebrities and kind of trying to bring family values back into Hollywood. If they were, I don't know, that's complicated, but that's what they think. And so that's the dystopian element, where we live in a world where we don't quite have fundamentalist white terrorists in America right now. But I think it's very plausible that we could. Okay, so after January 6th, things changed, right? But when I wrote this novel, which was a long time ago, we didn't have white Christian national terrorists in America. So it's a little bit more real than I was planning on it be, I guess.
And the disabilities, what inspired that story line? Could you tell us more about it?
Yeah, so I am a disabled author. I do not have the same disabilities as Jane, who has some PTSD and some mental health struggles, and then Daniel is an amputee.
Yeah.
But when I'm operating in a disability space, I cannot not write that. And so even if I'm writing completely able-bodied characters, I'm still writing from a perspective of living in a world that isn't quite as friendly to my body and my experiences as other people's, or whatever the imagined normal person is. And so I'm always thinking about how that operates, and especially in romance, where we don't as often look at less than perfect bodies as opportunities for a love story. And to have two of them falling in love together is also not particularly common. And so that was very important for me to have that and to be able to explore that possibility, and where they're coming as imperfect people. And that's okay. And it doesn't have to be like, I love you more because I'm able-bodied and you're not, or this weird imbalance, which we often get with disabled stories.
Very important. And I know we'll be expanding on that further in our discussion groups. And I'm going to see if anyone's dropped any questions for you. But in the meantime, I know you also have worked on a trilogy, which, you know, the third part just came out, which is really exciting. Congratulations. Can you tell us about that?
Thank you. It is very exciting. So this is very strange because I did not set out to be a romance writer. And after Battery Park came out and everyone was like, oh, yeah, well, this is a romance novel, I was like, oh, OK, so I guess I should do more of that. So I have a lot of other genres of novels and old works sitting around while I'm going around being a romance writer. And it's awesome because romance readers are so cool. And also people want a love story. I think even if you're not a romance writer and as a genre, having a love story, I think, is something we all really enjoy reading.
I was just agreeing with you. Go ahead.
So the series, it's called Elaborate Lives, and there's three of four books out. It was supposed to be a trilogy, as you said. And what happened was that the third book that I wrote this fall kept getting longer and longer and longer. And so now there are four books. And the second one hopefully will be coming out this spring, although because I didn't budget for four books, I'm going to have to do a Kickstarter to help cover some of the upfront costs. So that will be coming. Yeah, and I think it's really cool because with romance, you can do like all of these add-ons. Like I'm going to do like a date box with candles and scents and like little cards that go with the themes of the book. And I'm really excited about it. And I have like a kind of glamorous pins with the book's motto, and it's going to be really awesome. Anyway. So,
and available for Valentine's.
I'm hoping, yeah, 2024? I'm hoping to at least get it going for Valentine's Day. Yeah. Anyway, so the series also is set in Hollywood, and it's unlike Jane of Battery Park, which is completely clean, if you want to call it that. It does not have any on the page sex. Elaborate Lives is very much the opposite end of the spectrum. Where it is very steamy, there are some kinky elements, but it's really cool because if you've read Battery Park, then you'll recognize some of the characters. The other Hollywood actors also show up in this series, and they interact with a new set of characters who are involved in the industry and also trying to figure out how they are as people who haven't really had the opportunity to develop. We'll call them Arrested Development people, as the TV show taught us. It's very fun. It's very sexy. And there's a lot of options for it's just so much fun. That's what I'll say.
Very cool. Well, I'd love to share more information about your books and I guess your quad of books and the Kickstarter. So please do share that with us. I'll watch for it on your social and via email, and I'll be sure to share it with our community.
That would be awesome. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you so much. We keep these short and sweet. So I just want to say thanks for joining us. Have a wonderful holiday season.
You too. Thank you for having me.
Thanks. I'll talk to you soon. Thanks, Jay.
Bye.
Bye.